Welcome back to our intermediate financial accounting class. Over the last few segments, we've been talking all about the income statement, what it is, why it's important. We've built a multi-step income statement. We've added all sorts of special transactions and line items to it. But now we need to take a little bit of a break from our income statement and talk about the next statement in sequence. If you remember, we talked a couple of segments ago about the specific order that the financial statements need to be completed in so that we get the right information. So first we build our income statement because we need that net income number first. Once I have that net income number, then I can do a statement of retained earnings, which uses net income and dividends to get my new retained earnings balance. So that's what we're going to talk about this time, is a statement of retained earnings. After that, we'll talk a little bit more about earnings per share and some ratios, and then we'll start talking about the rest of the sequence, balance sheet, statement of cash flows. So that's what's coming. But for now, let's take a look at what goes into a statement of retained earnings. These are really simple statements. They really are. There's not much involved in coming up with a statement of retained earnings. We start out with retained earnings from last year, so our beginning balance. Remember, what we end with on December 31 is what we walk into on January 1. So ending balances at the end of this year become beginning balances for next year. So we're going to start with that number. And remember, we don't touch retained earnings at all year round, because we're doing normal entries, we're taking care of, we're recording expenses and revenues and gains and losses as they occur, but it's not till we finish the adjusting entries, finish the financial statements, and then do closing entries that we actually do adjustments to the retained earnings account, which means I've still got beginning retained earnings in my retained earnings account as I start making the financial statements. But in order to get my balance sheet to balance, I have to have ending retained earnings. And that's what this statement is for. So we're going to start with beginning retained earnings. We're going to add in any adjustments from prior periods if I've made mistakes that I've now corrected, if I've made some changes because of a gap rule that has changed, those go in there. If I've changed principal, we talked about that. This is one of the places where if you have a real change in principal, this is one of the things that gets hit. So that goes in here. Then I get retained earnings as of January 1 as adjusted. I add to that my net income from my income statement. I take out my dividends that I've declared over the course of the year, and that gives me my ending retained earnings. So let's go ahead and do one of these for CBDS. We're going to use the information from the original numbers. We're not going to do all those adjustments that we did in those last few segments where we change depreciation and we change bad debt expense. We're not going to do those. We're going to use the original numbers so that as we move through this process, everything balances. Because remember, we got this series, income statement, statement of retained earnings, balance sheet, cash flows. If we use weird numbers in our income statement, it's not going to balance all the way through. So we're going to go back to those original numbers and use them to make our statement of retained earnings. These are the numbers that I want to use for my statement of retained earnings, and specifically, I want to use this number, the 236,556. So let's go ahead. Down here I have another tab for the statement of retained earnings. We're going to click there. You can see retained earnings January 1 is reported. That's what I need first. And I'm going to get that from my trial balance. So let's go ahead and link it. Equals. We'll go to raw data. Retained earnings for the beginning of this year was the end of last year. So that's this 395 number. So let's go ahead and hit enter. You can see that when I resized this, made it a little bit bigger so it was easier to see, that it made it a little bit harder for Excel to display my numbers. So to fix that, you go up to the column heading and you can see how my cursor changes from the little plus sign to this little black double arrow. If I double click right there, now it's big enough that we can see those numbers. So we start with 395. This next line is going to be corrections or adjustments. What the line item will look like will depend on what kind of an adjustment you make. So I'm going to put in an example of what the formal statement would look like. Correction of understatement or overstatement of net income in prior periods. Again, there could be other line items here. This is just an example of what one might look like. For CBDS, we don't have any of those, so we're going to make it a zero, which means that our retained earnings January 1 as adjusted will look the same as the as reported number. Next, I'm going to add net income, and that's the number from my income statement. It was $263,556. And again, you're welcome to link it if you prefer. There's really not a title for this 658 because it doesn't really mean anything. We have to take out the dividends before we have a number that means anything. So let's go find our dividends number. We'll find that on our raw data tab right here. We paid $50,000 in dividends. And I'm going to show, let me go ahead, this is the one time I'll use this. So I'm going to mark this as used. I won't mark retained earnings as used because I still need it for my balance sheet. So we'll just leave it as is. Dividends, $50,000. And I'm subtracting that because it's less, the dividends. So less 50,000. So now there's my new value, the 608,566. That's going to be my retained earnings, December 31. And that's it. That's all there is to a statement of retained earnings. Now, this is a simplified statement. A lot of publicly held companies will actually report a statement of stockholders' equity, which is much more involved. But for now, I think this is as far as we need to go. We have to leave some of the fun for more advanced accounting courses. Now, before we end this segment, I do want to talk about one more thing, and that is comprehensive income. So let me go back to PowerPoint. We talked about comprehensive income as one of the elements of GAAP back in our discussion of the conceptual framework. Now I just want to review it briefly and talk about it in context now that we've done an income statement. So let's start with the formal definition. This is all changes in equity during a period except those resulting from investment by owners and distributions to owners. So basically, every single thing that's happened that doesn't include getting money from our owners or paying it back to them. The idea here is that there are things that change our asset values that we have no control over. And we don't want to put them in net income because the company really didn't make any decisions that caused a change. But we still have to show that the assets changed in value. So that's where you use this comprehensive income. So let's say I open up a plant in Mexico and I've made a big investment. I have a lot of assets now that are in pesos down in Mexico, and the peso changes relative to the dollar, the exchange rate changes. Well, now all those assets are worth more or less, depending on which way it went, than they were before, and my asset values have changed. But I didn't do that, right? Individual companies can't change exchange rates. It's a market or an economy effect that causes the exchange rates to drop or grow. Well, I have to show the change in assets, but since I didn't do it, companies really balked at being told, you have to put this in your income statement. So instead, we kicked it down into this comprehensive income. Currency translations is one example. Pension values are another one. Most companies, if they have a pension, they contribute money to it, and then it's invested by a professional firm. So I don't control how that's changing, and I don't control what's happening to my employees and their lifespan. So since I don't control it, then I don't have to put it in net income. It goes into comprehensive income. The other example are what we call available for sale securities, which are stocks and bonds that I purchased to sell someday, but I'm not trading them. I'm just saving up for something. Like I might be saving for an expansion fund or to repay some debt. So if a great deal comes up, I'll sell them, but I'm not trading them. And since I'm not trading them, the change in their values is a market effect, not something the business caused. And so because of that, those numbers don't show up in net income, they show up in comprehensive income instead. Now, FASB looked at that, and companies looked at that, and they had this big argument about where we put comprehensive income. And FASB really wanted it to be on the income statement, but companies rebelled. They said, "Nah, we don't want to have to put it there." So they came up with this compromise, and you can see down here at the bottom, I put in the three options under US GAAP. Option number one, you make a totally separate statement. So you have a statement of comprehensive income. It starts with net income. It adds in these other adjustments and then reports comprehensive income. That's one option. Option number two is you just stick it at the end of your income statement. So basically what you do is you have your normal income statement like we built, and then we add comprehensive income down at the bottom. The third option is to put it in a statement of stockholders' equity. Not a statement of retained earnings like we made, but a statement of stockholders' equity. And we actually see most companies putting it there. We've done some studies on why they might do that. We actually got a bunch of analysts together, not me, but researchers in accounting, got a bunch of analysts together, and they gave them the same set of data The only thing they changed in this set of financial statements they gave to these analysts was where comprehensive income was. So they gave to a third of them the first option, a separate statement of comprehensive income. They gave to the second group an income statement that had comprehensive income at the bottom, and they gave to the third group the comprehensive income in the statement of stockholders' equity. Well, it turns out when they tested these individuals, they all remembered the information, but only the ones that had a separate statement or the statement of net income version actually used comprehensive income information in making their investment decisions. Everybody else, they just ignored it. So what we found is people just don't pay as much attention to it if it's in the statement of stockholders' equity. And perhaps for that reason, most companies put it in the statement of stockholders' equity, because it's not typically a good thing. Can be, but often it's a negative number. So they seem to be hiding it a little bit. Now, under IFRS, there is a slight difference in the rule. IFRS started out using the same rules that we did. They allowed the same three options that we just discussed, but then they decided, nah, we don't like this. We don't like the fact that companies seem to be hiding this information. So they used the academic research that had been done, and they got rid of that third option. So you can still, under IFRS, you can still do it as a separate statement or put it at the bottom of your statement of profit or loss, but it can't go in a statement of stockholders' equity anymore. Now that wraps up our discussion of both the statement of retained earnings and comprehensive income. The only thing we have left is to talk about the ratios, and we'll do that in our next segment. I'll see you then.